I distinctly remember, like, there got to be a point in my kids' academic career where I could no longer help them with their math. Not because it was a new math, but because, like, I just don't remember how to do this anymore. It was like, you know, arithmetic is good, algebra is good, geometry is good. Start getting into calculus, it's like, I knew how to do that one time, you know, but not today. You're on your own, kid. Sorry. All right. What I want to do is I want to back up a little bit and take a look at what we had as our example last time and talk about it for a bit and review and make sure I make some points to review. And then we'll go on to start discussing web design. It would be a good idea for you to read the project requirements sometime before next week, because next week at some point we'll discuss the steps I want you to go through to create your project. So make sure if you have not already read that, read it. If you have already read it, take a look through it again just to make sure you understand. So let's pull down the example we had last time. And pretty much from now on through the rest of the semester, we're going to be traveling back and forth between CSS land and HTML land. So we'll be tackling those two things for the rest of the semester simultaneously. I did have a person ask me about downloading something that they had uploaded. They turned in their assignment, then they downloaded it again to take a look at it, to view it on another computer, and their links didn't work. Let me review that again. I think I mentioned it one time, but let me review that again. When you zip files up, notice that kind of looks like a folder, but it's actually everything smashed together into one file. So that actually is a single file. So if I go into that and I see the little button that says extract files, if I go into a file like this, notice it doesn't see my CSS. And this page doesn't see my images. It shows the images missing. And if I were to have a link between the two pages, that wouldn't work. And the reason for that is, even though it looks like they're separate files, if it says extract all files, they're actually smashed together into a single file. So it can't find the other file. So the link won't work, the style sheet won't work, the images won't work. So what you need to do to correct that is click the extract button and extract it. And then you'll see it's not a zip folder anymore. It's a regular folder. And now you can go into it and into the folder, and if you look at the page, you get the background with the image. Again, if it's inside the zip folder, you'll see the extract button, and if you go into it, none of the images work. If there were links to other of my pages, they wouldn't work. The CSS doesn't work. But if I extract it, then it works the way that it's supposed to. So if you zip something up and email it to me or submit the assignment, to view it again, you have to extract it again. It's sort of like freeze-drying it, right, or dehydrating it. You have to bring it back to life by extracting it. All right. We have two pages that I created here. And the thing that's significant about this, I got caught up by the exact thing I was talking about. It's like, why doesn't the style sheet show? All right, take two. All right, there we go. These two pages, again, look alike. They look alike in terms of the style sheet that they use, the color scheme for the fonts, and so on. That's a very desirable goal. That's one of the first design guidelines that we'll come up with when we discuss web design. Your pages should have a consistent look. That doesn't mean that every page needs to look identical to all the rest of them. You can have a little variation in layout or a little variation in any number of things, but they should have a consistent look. It shouldn't look as though you are going to different websites as you travel around your website. So, ideally, what we want to do is we want to achieve that goal by having a minimum of effort. So, in other words, if I were to decide, gee, I don't like the way that the green font looks against the blue, I want to change it to black, I should be able to make that change in one place and have it be made on all of the pages for my site. We accomplish that by separating the CSS and HTML into separate files. So let me go and open my web page, and then I will open the HTML for both pages, and then I will open the CSS file. Again, I have to click all files to see the HTML files. All right, so notice if we look at these files, the HTML itself does not have any CSS code in it. All right, normally in the previous examples that we did, the CSS code was part of the head section. Now we don't have that in this file. We just have a link to a style sheet. And the link should look exactly like this. Link rel equals style sheet, text/CSS. href equals style.css. Okay. Both of the pages have that. So both my Groundhog's Day page and my Groundhog's Movie page have the link to the same style sheet. That gives us the advantage that we can put all our style code on one page. All right. Notice that we don't have the style tag here. If you use a link to an external style sheet, you don't need to have the style tag. You can simply put the style code. But we can put any of that stuff in there, and it will apply then to both pages. Now, let's refresh our memory the way that style rules work. Oh, I have a mistake here. I forgot the ending curly brace. Interesting thing is that didn't seem to cause me any problems. Or maybe it did and I just didn't notice. Actually, let's open this up in Chrome. Actually, there is a problem that I didn't notice. I wanted the H2s to be black, and they're not. So if I go and save that then, there it fixes it. The good news is it fixes it in both pages. All right. So simply by changing the file in one place, I can change it in another. And that's great when you're talking about two pages, but when you talk about 15 pages, 20 pages, whatever, that becomes even a bigger deal. All right. In fact, companies will do that, right? Companies that are seasonal, you know, like a greeting card company, right? Greeting card companies have different times of the year. You know, they always sell birthday cards and that kind of card, but a lot of their business for greeting card companies come for the special holidays of the year, you know, Christmas, Valentine's Day, Mother's Day, and so on. Now, they might want a different color scheme or background images or anything like that depending on the time of the year and the holiday that's coming up. All right. Rather than having to go back and change all of their web pages on their site, they only need to change their CSS file. And that CSS file will affect every single page and will change the look of every single page so they can accomplish that. Let's review the way style sheet rules work. They consist of a selector, and the selector determines what on the page gets that rule. Inside of the braces, there's a series of pairs of attributes and values. An attribute, again, is a characteristic of the element. And the value is the value that you have. All right? Now, these are built-in. It's not like I can just go and make up any of these attributes. They're predefined. Likewise, the values are predefined. Color, for example, means the color of the text. So color represents the color of the text. This represents the color that I want. And if we remember the RGB rule, the first two relates to how much red is in it. So there's no red at all. The second pair relates to how much green is in it. And if you remember, the numbers go from 00 to AA. So 66 isn't a lot of green. So this would be a darker shade of green. And then finally, there's no blue. So if we look at this page, we kind of have a darkish green. How could we make the green darker? What would be a value that we could put in for green that would be darker than this? Would 60 be lighter or darker? It would be darker because there's less green. So it would be closer to black. Remember, 00 is black. So as we lower that number, there's less of it. So it would become darker. 30 would be darker still, though. So if I go and save this and look at it, notice that on this screen, it's almost impossible to tell that it is green. It almost looks like it's black or a shade of gray. But you can tell a little bit better on the monitor that it's a shade of green. Actually, not really. Let's go and make it a little bit bigger. Let's make it 50. All right. There, you probably can see it's green. I can see it's green on the screen. But it's a darker green. Now, selectors come in many forms. And we've only looked at one or two of the forms yet. The first form of a selector is where we have an HTML tag. That means everything in the body gets this look unless something comes along and overrules it. All right? So for example here, article H2, I've overruled and said the color, and the color means the color of the text, is going to be black. All right? So everything in the body gets this rule, but for H2s within an article tag, the text is going to have a color of black. So that's what this selector means. When you see two HTML tags, it means when you have this tag inside of this tag, it gets that rule. Now the background, because I haven't said anything about the background, it still gets the background of the body. That's the cascading part of CSS. If you have two rules, a rule for the body applies for everything, and that rule will take effect for everything unless something more specific comes along and overrules it. So in this case, I've overruled the color of the H2s within the article. In this case, for any paragraph, it doesn't matter where the paragraph is, I have defined it as having a background color of this and a text color of white. Here I made the links a certain color. Here I've made paragraphs within the footer have a background of white. Now later on we'll learn more selectors. For example, there may be one special paragraph on the page that we want to look different than everyone else. All right? Maybe it's like a breaking news item. You know, you've all gone to news websites and you see on the top of the page breaking news and it looks different than everything else on the page. All right? We can define a style rule for just a single element by using either an ID or a class. So we'll take a look at that in future lectures, but we're not going to cover that right now. All right? The other thing to say is that, again, we've just scratched the surface both with selectors and with the different attributes or characteristics that we can set. We can change everything on the page, the appearance of it, via CSS. All right? We can make a different font. We can make the font size bigger. We can make different colors. We can put background images. We can change the position. We can change the spaces between things. Anything that deals with the visual aspect of the page, the way the page looks, we control via our CSS. Any questions on this? So I guess the point I'm trying to make is, especially when we consider that this is just a preview of CSS, that we haven't really gotten into all details, all right, we can take any one web page and make it look wildly different. All right? And it's called CSS Zen Garden. And this page really consists of only one thing. All right? One web page. One web page. One web page that has multiple different CSS files applied to it. So let's look at some of the things on the page so that we recognize them when we see them on other pages. There's the word CSS Zen Garden. There's the word the beauty of CSS design. View designs. A demonstration of what can be accomplished through CSS-based design. The road to enlightenment. So what is this all about? Participation and so on. So now what I can do is I can click View All Designs and I can see that same page formatted a whole bunch of different ways. And notice these aren't small differences. These are big, major differences. This page here is the identical HTML that we saw a minute ago. In fact, let me do this. This page and this page is the exact same HTML. There's just different CSS. And we can spot things that they have in common. CSS Zen Garden, the beauty of CSS design. The beauty of CSS design, CSS Zen Garden. See, the text is oriented vertically here. The text is much bigger here. Different background images and so on. And we can go to other ones. CSS Zen Garden, the beauty of CSS design, a demonstration of what can be accomplished. Again, identical HTML with different CSS. So this is as good of example as I can think of the power that you have with CSS, the power to make your page look any way that you want to, and the power to take a single page and have it displayed many different ways. Now, this site was created mainly as a teaching tool, but there's some practical implications of this as well. All right, I already mentioned one example of a company that is does seasonal business, where they want their page to look like the season that it is. You know, a greeting card company wants their page to look like Valentine's Day when it's the Valentine's Day season, right? And Christmassy when it's the Christmas season, and so on down the line. But it also has implications when we talk about developing websites that work on a mobile phone, all right? Because there's restrictions and limitations for a mobile phone that you don't have when you're viewing the web page on a computer, right? The screen's smaller. It's a little harder to interact and to click on things and so on. So web developers could go and put a different CSS file if you're viewing it on a mobile device versus on a desktop device. So this is a very important concept, to be able to take one web page and be able to display it several different ways. All right. Now, as Spider-Man would say, or someone that I'm not really a comic book person, but I do remember Spider-Man said, or someone said to Spider-Man, with great power comes great responsibility, right? Thank you. I knew at least, I don't know why, but somehow I knew someone in a computer information systems class would know the answer to that one, all right? It's just like if I make a comment about Star Wars, usually I get, you know, no, that didn't, that happened on Tatooine or whatever, you know, it's like, all right. So, however we want to. But that comes with great responsibility. And I always say, I think even from the first or second lecture, that web development consists sort of two sides. There's the technical aspect. In other words, how do I do this? How do I make the background of my page an image? How do I change the font? How do I make the type bigger? Those are technical questions that you can look up. The one thing that's a little harder to develop is the design skill. In other words, what can I use to make a page look good and help my user navigate their way through the web page and understand what's going on that web page by using the different things such as the color, the font, spaces between things, and so on. Notice, for example, on this page, just to pick the one that's currently up, the spaces between the elements help the user visually organize the page. This is the title of the page. This is the purpose. Here's a little blurb about it. Here's a little blurb about it. Notice that these two pieces of text are in different color. Why do you suppose that is? Because they're links, right? You don't have to guess, gee, what's the link? What do I click on to download it? You can obviously tell, based on the visual language that they used, that white background, black text, means a link. All right, so they better make other links look the same way, right? Because you're expecting it to look like that. Now, with CSS, we could learn ways to make every single link on the page look different. All right, technically, we are able to do that. We have that power. However, that's probably not a good idea because that will confuse the user. So if you overuse things such as color and font and all these things, you don't use them carefully and with judgment, instead of making the web page more clear, you're making the web page more confusing for your user. So sure enough, if we scroll down here, well, looky here. There's another link. Immediately we know that's a link because it looks different than the other text. We know these are links. We know this is a link. And so on down the line. One thing I do sometimes with my classes is I pull up a news site from another country in another language. All right? All right. This is a good example as any. Does anyone speak Polish? All right. What is this? This area here. The navigation. Why? I thought you said you didn't speak Polish. How do you know that? You do? No, I was going to say that. Oh, okay. I probably know 3 or 4 words. Not enough to tell that that's a navigation bar, but yet I know it's a navigation bar. Why do you know that? Because of the way it looks. Because typically on websites, what usually appears, if you see a bar of things going across the top of the page, you have been taught to understand that as a navigation bar, right? That's part of what I would call a visual language, right? In other words, you don't even have to read the words or understand the words to understand the meaning of that. All right? So there's certain conventions that happen on websites, and that's one of them. All right? What is this? Well, it's pretty obvious because it is in English, but it's an ad. All right? What's the most important news story on here? Okay. Yeah. Probably the one with the picture that has the biggest headline and the one that has a picture. Notice that we have different sections. Actually, this is mixed between Polish and English, which is interesting. All right. Over here we have most popular news stories. And so on. The point is, that was an okay example. Sometimes I find better examples. The idea is simply based on how a page looks, we can make some conclusions about what the content is. And that's our goal in designing a web page, to help our user be able to quickly, at a glance, understand our page, how it's organized, and what the content is. There's a good book, I think the author's name is Stephen Krug, called Don't Make Me Think About Web Development. People don't go to your web pages to admire how beautiful your design looks, believe it or not. All right? Does that mean that you don't try to make it look good? No, of course you try to make it look good. But just as important, or I would even argue more important, you want to design it to make it functional. So therefore, the things that you put on the page, the color, the spacing between things, the fonts that you choose, all that are things that should help direct the user through your page and understand how the page is laid out, how the page is organized. So Your next assignment, if I'm not mistaken, or one of your assignments, is to find a couple pages that you think are well designed and a couple of pages that you think are poorly designed. So my example to this point really is to show you two things. All right, what I've talked about so far in this class, other than the review segment, was to illustrate two things. First of all, the power that you have with CSS. And secondly, how by the way that you visually format the page can help the user understand how your page is organized and can make your site more functional. I'd like to go into more detail now about what makes a web page well-designed or poorly designed. All right? So think about that question for a second. Does anyone care to volunteer a page that you think is either well-designed or poorly designed? Because usually what we can do is we can start in either direction. We can talk about a page that's well-designed and look at what's good about it, or we can look at a page of that's poorly designed and look what we don't like about it and kind of assume that probably the opposite is true. It's like, you know, I don't know, I saw one of those silly signs that they have in the office, something like, everyone that I meet is an example. Some people are good examples, some people are bad examples, right? Or something like that. Or everyone brings joy into this room. Some people bring it by coming into the room, some people bring it by leaving this room, or something like that. So almost everything we look at, good or bad, can teach us something. Does anyone have an example of a good or bad website that you like to discuss? Yes? Gate World? All right. I will say, when we pick on these sites, if we mention bad ones, let's focus on sites for like a business. In other words, people that should know better, right? Let's not pick on, you know, a website that, you know, some kid did as a Justin Bieber fan site just as a hobby or something like that. All right, so Skate World, what is the address of that? Okay, I'll Google it then, Lorraine. And this, I love skating at Skate World, so I apologize for using you as a bad example if you happen to be watching this. Oh, I changed the language to Polish. I say, let's see, can I change it back? Yes, good, good. All right, here we go. Okay. What is bad about that? The background is overwhelming, and there's too much going on. And the background could even make it very difficult to read in some cases. Right. Yeah, the color scheme seems to be used, someone showing off the fact that they've learned how to make things different colors, right? Because they make things different colors without any rhyme or reason, all right? Now, here's the interesting thing. And again, this is going to sound like terribly sarcastic, but it's not intended to be, that it took work to make the page look like this, right? If someone really literally didn't do anything with the appearance of it and just did a plain basic HTML site, it probably would work better for them, all right? As opposed to putting forth an effort and coming up with that. I don't like the fact someone pointed out that when you click on that, in some cases anyhow, well, that's a whole other issue. The links don't work always. But on some of them, when you click on it, the link disappears. All right, that's kind of confusing. You know, it's good to have a consistent navigation and so on. There, we click on that one, it goes away. That one, well, the link stopped working. And again, here you have different colors, and It's really hard to see on the monitor, but there's some text over here. And then there's some text over there. There's really no difference between those texts. They're made different colors for no real rhyme or reason. Sometimes I joke that, you know, when people first learn web development and they learn all the things they can do, it's like taking someone to an all-you-can-eat buffet, right? They got to try some of everything, right? And they got to overdo it and do a lot of different things on the page. Whereas it might be better picking and choosing what you're going to do and have the page, you know, be a little more simpler, all right? Anyone else have either a good or a bad example? Yes. Okay. This one? Okay. What do you like about it? Okay. Okay. So you see this, you have no doubt about where you landed, right? You're on First Merit Bank site. That's important. Someone made the comment about Skate World that it wasn't necessarily obvious what it was when you viewed that page. Whereas this page is pretty obvious where it is. Notice how they follow a lot of the common conventions for web development. All right? And there's a place to be creative and to do things your own way, but there's also a time to sort of follow the standards that other people have. So, I'm going to close my eyes and point to where the search is. The search is probably right up here. Oh, looky there. I got my finger right on it. Well, you can't see that on there, but trust me, I did. All right. How did I know that? That's where usually the search is, right? So, I could be creative, and you could say, well, you know, I'm not going to do what other people do, and I'm going to put my search bar down here. The problem is if people expect to see it up here, then, you know, it's not going to work. Just like you can make a volume knob on your TV that if you turned it to the left, it made it louder, and you turned it to the right, it made it quieter, right? You could do that, right? And it's probably not difficult at all to do that. But you're going to confuse everyone in the world who's used to turning it to the left, or I'm sorry, turning it to the right to make it louder and turning it to the left to make it quieter. All right. What I like about this is, you mentioned the tabs. What's good about that is I come in here, I may not know exactly what I want, but I know, gee, am I an individual that wants banking? Am I representing a business? Am I involved in some commercial venture? And I know based on that where I want to go to. All right. So if I'm a businessman looking for a loan, I go over to business and I can look and see, all right, these are the things for me, as opposed to a person who might be buying a house. So what they've done is they've divided their customers into groups and said, well, here's our three or four most common kinds of customers. And those customers are interested in these things typically. So let's make it obvious. For personal banking, you click here. For businesses, you click here. That's a challenge for very large sites, right? Very large sites have an awful lot of content on them. And it's very difficult to organize, or it can be very difficult to organize a site so that people can find what they're looking for. By far, that is one of the most common complaints I hear people when I do this part of this class is, I can't find what I'm looking for on this site. It's confusing to find what I'm looking for. And that's certainly one of the biggest issues with sites. Whereas this site was put together from the customer's point of view. Okay? You may not know what department handles mortgages or commercial loans or whatever, but you know if you're a person or a business. So that's your starting point. How many colors are used here? Not too many, right? There's blue because apparently that's their logo. And wherever they need a little bit, a splash of color, they use that shade of blue. Apparently they've merged with Huntington, so they're using the green from Huntington in a couple of places. But most everything is white and black with some shades of blue. Yes?
So at the bottom of the page.
Yeah, exactly. These are things you're coming from. All right? Job. Where is my nearest branch? I don't know why you'd want to follow a bank on Twitter or, you know, find out when they're giving away free money or something. I don't know. If it's the mic dead, I'm going to throw a tantrum. Do you know that in the 8 classes that we've had, this has happened probably 3/4 of the time? I don't know why it's so difficult to get me a mic that can work every time. I've never had this problem before, but it happens every time just about this semester. This is getting ridiculous. Then use one of those mics that just plugs in to the thing. You know, until you figure out what the issue is, go with the solution that you know is going to work. You know, the one that sits on the desk. All right, thank you. Yeah, and people, you know, and I really feel bad because I think, you know, and normally they even do a really good job. I mean, every other semester they've done this, they've recorded them, not a problem, you know, and they do this. But it's like, the first time it happened, okay. The second time it happened should be a sign that there's a problem that's bigger than just the fact that coincidentally one of the microphones went dead. I don't know if this is like, you know, like when your phone gets old, the battery only charges for like 20 minutes, you know, and then it's dead again. If it's that, if the battery eventually goes bad on these things. But like, come on. Yeah, and the blue light is on, so I don't know what that means. So normally, like when the battery goes out, like it goes out. So, you don't happen to be like a stockholder in First Merit, are you? Okay. See, there you go. All right. Well, yeah, that's a case of, within reason, it doesn't hurt to put the links in a couple different places. All right? Now, again, you know, you have the links up here. As long as you're not cluttering it, have links in a couple different places. That way, wherever a person happens to be, they can go and they can find it and they can go there. Yeah, I would imagine. The difference is if I click on this, I get that page for personal, whereas if I click on mouse over this, I get the drop-down menu. All right, thank you. Okay.
So again, the question was raised that some of the links are duplicate down here and up here. And that's true. And as long as it's not over clutter, it's okay to have links on two places on a page. And they should go to the same place. So I click that and I go to the personal index for people that are visiting it versus businesses that are visiting it. And if I go here, if I mouse over, I get a drop-down menu. But if I click that, I go to that same page. All right. It is important, and again, this is another aspect of consistency, that the same things are called by the same terms everywhere you use them. So for example, what would be wrong is if I had personal up here, but if I had individuals down here, right? Now, you and I might understand that individuals and personal banking is like the same thing. You know, it's for a human, not for a business or a corporation or whatever. But if you use different terms to refer to the same thing, that can be very confusing. And people can look at it and not understand, that they mean the same thing. Does anyone else have an example, either good or bad? Oh, Leo Burnett in Canada. Yep. Do you like this or not like this?
I think this is a pretty bad example.
Yeah, this text is very... Pardon me?
Hard to understand what this site's about.
Exactly. That's one thing I would say for this. Now, Leo Burnett happens to be a very famous advertising agency, but if you don't know that, you look at this, it's pretty confusing. All right? This is very hard to read, all right? I mean, I would have to, you know, I would have to be this far away from it to be able to read that very closely. I will say that some things they do on this page are okay or good. I think it's kind of cool as you go scroll down, those little things sort of slide in from the side. That gives a little bit of visual appeal. But overall, yeah, it is kind of busy, all right? And I would say it doesn't hurt to make it obvious what your organization is. Other examples of either good or bad. Actually, Leo Burnett's actually used to be way worse than this. Leo Burnett's used to come to and get a pencil. Here we go. This is what you used to get to when you visited Leo Burnett's page. Their signature And as you moused around, you get these links. You look at that, you have absolutely no idea what Leo Burnett is. Exactly. And far be it, you know, maybe it's not my place to criticize them, because Leo Burnett's probably doing a lot better than I am financially, right? All right. But the point is you do need to know what this is before that even makes sense. What they're really trying to do is they're really trying to showcase their creativity, because they're an advertising agency. They're the people that made Tony the Tiger, for example, and Snap, Crackle, and Pop, I believe, all right, all those Kellogg's characters. So they're on the ball. They know what they're doing, and they're very creative. However, from a web design perspective, it still wouldn't hurt to tell you and direct you and make it a little easier for you to get your way around rather than guessing at that. So that's a good argument that they're meant to showcase their technical and creative skills, but I think they take that a little too far and sacrifice a bit of clarity in doing that. So when I look at the new Leo Burnett page, I think it's great compared to this. All right, because again, it's a lot clearer to me what Leo Burnett's about looking at that page than looking at this page. Yeah, they do have. That ought to be a tip-off to you. If you have to put a link on your page that says, if you are confused, click this, then the solution isn't to put a link on your page that says, if you're confused, click this. The solution is to make your page less confusing. All right? Now, there's a place for you to showcase your creative skills. You know, especially like this. An ad agency, they want to show that they're head and shoulders above everyone else. I would argue that place is not your homepage, because people land on that, they're going to get confused, they're liable to just give up. Now, your point about it being geared toward a specific audience, maybe they don't care if your average Joe comes to this page and says, I don't know what that is, I'm going away, because the people that do know who Leo Burnett is might be dazzled by it. So, I could see that, but on the whole, I would sort of critique it for that reason. All right, we'll continue with this on Tuesday. And what I aim to do is, after we've discussed this for a while and come up with some good qualities and bad qualities, we'll take a step back and we'll say, let's come up with a list of web design guidelines. After we do that, then, we'll discuss the process that I want you to go through in creating your project. All right, that's all I had. We'll see you up in Lamb.